Now, it was really inspiring to me to see how Kate was feeding the birds, but she was also providing that crucial nesting material. I've never done that. But you have kindly sent us some photographs of birds using some very unusual nesting materials. Have a look at this. Now, Ab, at 50, has sent us... These are jackdaws, and they're literally pulling fur out of the back of a horse. I hope he doesn't hurt. And they're dragging that off to make their nests. Nice and cosy. Have a look at this next one. Blue tit. Tennis balls turn out to be very popular items. They rip the yellow off it and they stick it in their nests. Delightful.
All the fabric that they choose, though, is amazing. And actually making the nest. I mean, take a look at this. These are some old nests. They've been used. The adults were never going to go back to them, that we found around the reserve. This bird has been raiding the old moss garden, and it's made this fabulous smooth mud cap inside. And that's typical of a song thrush. No other British bird makes a nest like the song thrush does. This one over here, made out of fine twigs and grass, that's black cap. Or perhaps garden warbler, hardly any lining at all in there, and a very fragile little nest. Quite how it managed to fashion that, I don't know. And then lastly, we've got the wren here. And this one's a domed nest, and it's completely covered in bracken, almost like a camouflage, really.
It's beautiful. Let us go round all of the nests, or some of the nests here at Inisheer, and see how birds have created them. Now, here is a pied flycatcher. They don't do much work, they'll just use a hole in the tree. And here's a tree creeper, again, they don't actually make one, they'll just use a convenient crack. Greater spotted woodpecker, they have to work hard. They will whack holes in the tree. How they don't get a headache, I don't know. We actually saw that nest a little bit earlier. And a meadow pipit here, now that's right down on the ground. At ground level, it'll make that nest not much of a nest. Now the wren, as we've seen, much more complicated structure. They'll make up to 6 different nests and entice the female in there, the male will. And here's a crow. It's not a great nest, really, just a few sticks around, a little bit of softer lining in there, but at least it has the advantage of being up a tree and therefore quite protected from predators.
One of the key features of nests is, of course, security. And there was a nest that we were looking at yesterday, actually, where security has been taken to an extreme because they actually make a tunnel over the water. I'm talking about kingfishers, of course. Now, we introduced you to these birds. These were on our river, quite close to our studio. And when we left them yesterday, they were going in and out there, showing us that they actually had chicks in that nest because they were bathing and moving out of the water.
But it wasn't actually, Chris, the safe haven those two adults were hoping for. And yesterday we had a dramatic turn of events. One of our remote cameramen noticed this on the river. He noticed that something was swimming towards the nest. Was it an otter? No. It was a very elusive animal, a mink.
It was indeed. And once a mink finds something, it doesn't forget about it, because the mink almost immediately came back to the nest. Look at this. It approaches it across the river. I think it's heard those youngsters, because they're obviously quite large. When it climbs up, which it does with remarkable alacrity, you see the adult bird coming out and also one of the eggs falling out. That must have been an unhatched egg that was left in the nest. Look at this, there you just see it dropping into the water. In the mink goes, into the burrow, and almost immediately it's backing out, and in its mouth it's got one of the young kingfishers. Off it goes across the river, but look, the adults are pretty tenacious. They're dive bombing the mink, but within a matter of seconds, it's coming back across the river.
Oh, look at that!
In again, the parent dive bombs, but it's not going to be put off. And by now, it knows exactly where it's going. It's up and in, and then it's backing out with yet another one of the chicks. And it's removing it. It's putting it somewhere safe where it knows it can access it. I mean, this is a bit like supermarket shopping. If you go to the supermarket, you don't go home with one tin of beans. You fill up your trolley, and effectively, that's what the mink is doing here. It's foraging optimally. It's taking advantage of a source of food which might run out. In fact, it looks as if it's run out here. It's come back out without any of those. But then it does something remarkable because it drops down into the water, heads back across the other side of the river, and it finds something else to eat.
Now, what's really interesting about this is that it won't waste, nature doesn't waste things. And the mink then continued to do something very, very interesting. Have a look at this. Having eaten that egg, it then started to move the kingfisher chick bodies around, and it will be caching them. So what it's doing is that it's found this wonderful food source for it, and it's now going to hide away all the chicks so that it can return later on and gather them up again. And probably, interestingly, May is the peak time for mink to give birth. So it may well be that this mink has kits of its own, and it'll be storing this food supply, which will then subsequently refind. Nothing ever gets wasted, and it'll bring back to its chicks in the nest.
You can really see the size of those chicks, can't you? We thought they were going to be quite bigger, and clearly they were.
Nearly ready to go.
They were almost ready to go.
Very sadly.
That's why they were making so much noise. Most of the predation occurs at nest when the chicks are at their largest size. They make more noise, more visits from the adult, more obvious to predators like the mink.
But, Chris, all that work, weeks and weeks of work from the kingfishers, and it was all over in more or less
minutes.
Seconds.
Minutes.
Incredible to get that footage, because that is really, really rare behaviour. And obviously that was a good day for our mink and its young, not a good day for our kingfisher pair. And this is what happened after. One of the adults came back with a fish in its mouth, all ready to feed the chicks. You can see that the head of the fish is facing forward, ready to put in those chicks' mouths. It's a very big fish. It goes in, it comes out again, obviously because there are no chicks in there, a little bit confused. It starts turning the fish around so that the head is pointing inside its beak, because that's how the kingfishers eat. Having a little bit of a job there.
It's a massive fish.
It's a huge fish. And eventually it swallows it. But the good thing is, it's obviously, you know, a healthy adult, and should be able to have more chicks, another nest and more chicks.
It's already going the right direction. I mean, it's building up its reserves, and there's no doubt whatsoever that these kingfishers will try again. Let's have a close-up at the mink, though, because we didn't really see its face there. Remember, this is a non-native animal. It's come in from North America. It's made a bit of a nuisance of itself. We think that it's been responsible for a serious decline in our water voles, and they do eat about a third of their diet's birds, normally ground-nesting birds, to be honest with you. But if you're thinking of picking on the mink, do also remember that otters eat birds at this time of year as well. And at the end of the day, it takes a lot to make the world go round, and one of the components is predation.
Now, from the rather exotic mink to the very commonplace rabbit. Now, rabbits, everyone knows all about rabbits, and surely there's nothing more to say about them. You'd be surprised. Have a look at this.
The rabbit. They're cute, they're fluffy, and there's around 45 million of them in the UK. These are the grassy knolls of the University of East Anglia. Sandy soil ideal for burrows, and enough cover close by. And the perfect opportunity for long-term research into rabbits, which has revealed a side of rabbits we rarely see. Rabbit warrens contain large populations, but within these, they live in small social groups of up to 9. The female produces 2 or 3 litters a year, each litter with up to 10 young, or kits. Once the kits emerge from the warren, they're no longer fed by their mother, even though they're just 3 weeks old. In spring, the female's fur appears patchy as she removes it to use as nest material. The dominant male, here on the right, can stay with the dominant female for life. The male must remain vigilant against any rivals. He patrols his territory. He urinates and scent marks by rubbing his chin and then paw scrapes. This marks his patch. While he waits for the female to be ready to mate, he sprays urine on her. The female shows she's now ready, wafting pheromones into his face. But then a rival male attempts to separate her from the dominant male. The contender runs in parallel and makes his own scrapes in the ground. Then a jump fight. It's fleeting and over quickly. The contender loses. But it's not only the males that are aggressive. During breeding from January to June, the dominant female is the most violent rabbit in the warren. Determined her young have the best food, she'll chase other females away, even ones she's closely related to. It's not only other rabbits that are a threat. For predators everywhere, rabbits are food. Rabbits can detect smell and sound very quickly. Eyes that are set on the sides of their skull give them a wide field of vision. They sit on their hind legs to see further, on constant watch for predators. Elsewhere on the site, one of their most persistent predators is spotted. Over 90% of all kits are killed by predators or disease during their first year. With such a high mortality rate, it's a good thing that rabbits breed, well, like rabbits. One female can produce up to 30 kits a year. Life for an individual rabbit is a risky business. But their phenomenal breeding rate helps ensure their survival.
The secret world of the rabbit. Who'd have thought that was so complex? Now, it's lovely to get that sort of insight into the rabbit's world, but Joyce Griffin from Glasgow has shown us something about rabbits that I never thought we would ever see. Have a look at this. This is Joyce's footage. Now, this is a rabbit. This is a subordinate female. Now, the dominant female has not allowed her to give birth in the main warren, so she's had to think a bit laterally. Now, what is she doing? You might think she's digging for food or something, but watch closely. Out of that hole come three tiny baby rabbits. And they are suckling there. She has hidden the rabbits away from the warren, her babies. She comes once a day, just for a few minutes. She gives them a meal of fantastically rich milk. They feed up, and then, incredibly, she very carefully backfills that hole. It's called a stop, in fact. She carefully moves the mud over that stop, and she won't come back to those three little babies until the next day. And Joyce filmed this, apparently, at 6 a.m. every single morning for a week. Joyce, thank you very much indeed. I have read about that. I never dreamt in my life I would actually see it. And please do keep those sort of films coming to us. We love to see them. bbc.co.uk/springwatch.